to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? It's always tease, tease, tease. You're happy when I'm on my knees. One day it's fine, the next it's black. So if you want me off your back, well come on and let me know. Should I stay or should I go? Should I stay or should I go now? Should I stay or should I go now? If I go, there will be trouble. Decisions bugging me.
Decision, they molest
me. If you don't want me, set me free.
Set me carelessly.
Exactly whom I'm supposed to be.
Hey,
don't you know which clothes even fit me? Come on and let me know. Should I cool it or should I blow? Should I go now? Should I stay or should I go now? If I go, there will be trouble. And if I stay, it will be double. So you gotta let me know. Should I cool it or should I blow? Should I stay or should I go now?
Okay, I'm here with you on a beautiful Spreaker evening here on Spreaker.com and venturing out to ask, what is it that makes us attractive? Now, before when I used to do my show, I had what was called the subject horn. That is Mr. Horny the Clown here. When you hear Horny the Clown, it's actually Honky the Clown. He's not quite as strong as Horny the Clown. He's a little bit squeakier, but here he is nonetheless. When you hear Honky, thank you, that's enough. Thank you, thank you. No, hold on. Getting. Sorry about that. Anyway, when you hear Honky Honk, his little horn, then we're going to be changing subjects. But it was brought to my attention earlier, what makes a person attractive? Is it the classic look? Is it the 6'2", eyes of blue? Or what are we attracted to? What is it about the opposite sex that makes us attracted? Can we be friends with the opposite sex? That's another topic we're going to look at tonight. Can you be friends with a girl? I resort back to this classic tale that I'm sure most of us are familiar with, at least if you're listening to the broadcast, you would be, which was...
Men and women can't be friends, because no man can be friends with a woman that he finds attractive. He always wants to have sex with her.
So you're saying that a man can be friends with a woman he finds unattractive?
No, you pretty much want to nail him, too. Grape?
No, I don't like to eat between meals.
I'll roll down the window. A faceless guy rips off your clothes, and that's the sex fantasy you've been having since you were 12. Exactly the same.
Well, sometimes I varied it a little.
Which part?
What I'm wearing.
You tell her about other women.
Yeah. Like the other night. I made love to this woman, and it was so incredible. I took her to a place that wasn't human. She actually meowed.
You made a woman meow?
Are you comfortable?
Sure. I need to talk.
What happened?
What's the matter?
Mary came over last night.
I went over to Sally's last night.
Because I was upset that Joe was getting married.
And one thing led to another.
And before I knew it, we were kissing.
To make a long story short,
we did it.
They did it.
You're challenging.
I'm difficult. I'm too structured. I'm completely closed off.
But in a good way.
And I'm gonna be 40.
When?
Someday.
In 8 years.
It's not the same for men. Charlie Chaplin had babies when he was 73.
Yeah, but he was too old to pick them up.
So that's another topic we're going to be talking about tonight on the broadcast, which is, can you be friends? Stop it. Hang on, everybody. Get him out of here now. Stop. Thank you. Sorry about that interruption, fellas. We're back now with Honky the Clown. What happened to Horny the Clown? The baby got it? We'll take it back from the little brat. I'm on the air. Oh. I'm sorry. We did have Horny the Clown, but I'm told that he was abducted by the federal government for some back taxes. They seem to come around here a lot for back taxes. So back to the broadcast here. Okay, thank you. That's another one. Women faking orgasms. Do women fake orgasms? I don't know. Let's listen to a fake orgasm and you judge. You be the judge.
Well, they haven't faked it with me.
How do you know?
Because I know.
Oh. Right. That's right. I forgot. You're a man.
What is that supposed to mean?
Nothing. It's just that all men are sure it never happened to them, and most women at one time or another have done it, so you do the math.
You don't think that I can tell a difference?
No.
Get out of here.
Ooh. Oh. Ooh.
Are you okay?
Oh. Oh, God. Ooh. Oh, God. Oh. 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 Oh, God. Oh, yeah, right there. Oh. 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 Oh, God. Oh, yes. 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 Oh. Oh, yes. 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 Oh. Yes. 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 Oh. 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 Oh, God. Oh.
I'll have what she's having.
Sleep. And if some of you don't know, the woman that said, "I'll have what she's having," is the mother of Mel Brooks? Now watch me blow that sky high. The guy that was on the show All in the Family, he played the part of Meathead. He's the one that did the movie. He was the producer, I believe, or the director, one of those people. That was his mother. She did the obligatory, "I'll have what she's having." So there you go with Meg Ryan, one of my heroes before she had plastic surgery, proving that, yes, you can be pretty convincing when it comes to the female orgasm. So there we have three topics up for discussion tonight on the Debbie Daly Show. And I have some people, I believe, that are going to be coming on with me shortly. So before we get to that, we will play a song for all of you boys out there, which happens to be a song that maybe I don't agree with, but it packs a powerful message. And it's what happens when a woman is scorned. When you break up with a woman that doesn't necessarily want to be broken up with, and how she reacts to said breakup. I'll be right back to kickstart the show as soon as this song gets over with. And again, this is not really what I would do, not really how I personally would react, but how I have personally witnessed many women react when broken up with.
I want you to know that I'm happy for you. I wish nothing but the best for you both. I know the version of me. Is she perverted like me? Would she go down on you in a theater? Does she speak eloquently? And would she have your baby? I'm sure she'd make a really excellent mother. Cause the love that you gave that we made wasn't able to make it enough for you to be open wide. No. And every time you speak her name, does she know how you told me it won't be until you die? Till you die, but you're still alive. And I'm here to remind. Wasn't able to make it enough for you to be open wide. No.
Damn it.
Damn
you ought to know.
I do.
Well, you ought to know.
I do, so I guess I ought to just write.
I love that song. I mean, I don't love that song. It's got a great beat. It's got good intention. But, you know, that's really a bitch, you know?
You know, the first time I heard that song by Alanis Morissette, I was like, it's okay. I don't like it. I don't like her whiny squealiness, but I love the lyrics. And, you know, when you're scratching, the scratching of the back and the cussing. And you have the edited version there, obviously. But
no, I did not. She said every word.
Oh, you got the F word was in there?
Yes.
Okay, I was connecting at the time, so I turned off the audio. But wow.
Oh, yeah.
Because the other day you played it, it didn't have. It was edited.
Oh, no, it's the same version I've uploaded a long time ago. It's You Ought to Know by Alanis Morissette, and I've never changed versions.
Okay.
She goes, and every time you da-da-da. Yeah, oh, absolutely. No. I don't believe in editing music. I mean,
but it comes like that sometimes. You know, when you download it, it'll be the clean version.
Right, but not the case here.
Cool.
So, yeah, there you go.
There you are.
So we have some more people that are going to join us tonight, or at least one that I know of. Mr. Midnight Movie will be coming on to join us on our panel to discuss certain topics. And I'm going to be changing topics because Honky the Clown, which I had.
I was going to ask.
Well, I had Horny the Clown, and I got Honky now, which I don't really. I think I'm going to call him Squeaky the Clown. You know?
Squeaky.
I used to have Horny the Clown, and Horny was a good, you know, he was like, honk, 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 honk. He was that good old...
Fashion. He was a good old fashion
right.
clown.
Well, no, he was that nice, bellowy sound that you have when you have a horn honking, but this is not, he's just not adding up, but the baby got horny, and I don't know if the baby got horny. I don't know what he did with him. He did something with him. He's somewhere between this house and that house and the other house.
So what happened? You called it Honky the Horn as I was listening in.
No, I was... Well, the original one was Horny the Clown. He used to be on my show a couple of years ago. And then I went with Squeaker. Squeaker was in... It was an old Squeaky that was in a squeak toy of one of my dogs.
Right.
And it was a Squeaky. You know, squeak, squeak, squeak. And this one is kind of in between Squeaky and Horny. So what do you think? Listen to him. Say something. Oh, don't act like that. Don't act.
Hey, hey now.
What does he sound like?
Sounds like you're squeezing a small dog.
There he is.
Doesn't that sound like one of those little purse dogs? What do they call them? Teacups?
Yeah, but, well, I don't know.
It's trying to bark.
It's just, it's got a great big red ball on the end of it, and you push. It goes on a bicycle, I guess.
Oh.
But you're ruining the effect. It's Sorry. Actually a clown that's over here.
Okay. What's his name?
I don't know. I'm going to call him Honky the Clown.
Okay, Honky the Clown, beautiful. I'm writing this down in case I need to talk to Honky.
Is that okay, Honky? Are you sure? You don't mind being... I said... Oh, see, he start. Stop. Stop it.
This is how those honkies are. You know, once they get on a show, they just can't stop bloviating.
Stop.
Hey, right back at you, pal.
So I have I have bowler's arm today.
And what are how do you have bowler's arm?
I went bowling, and I only used a 6-pound ball.
6-pound ball, Debbie.
But I did good. I scored a lot of strikes and a lot of spares.
I don't know how to do that. I'm not very good.
Mr. Midnight Movie's an excellent bowler. He uses a 16-pound ball.
Well, I do too. It doesn't make me excellent, so I would never challenge him in that.
I am so thirsty today. Do you ever have those days where you cannot drink enough of anything?
Because you went bowling.
Mm-hmm.
I'm always drinking. I forever drink water. 2 gallons a day.
I drink milk. I live on milk.
Mm-hmm.
I drink about, you know, Stephen asked me last night, Mom, how much milk do you drink? I probably pack away a half a gallon a day.
It's good for you.
Is it really? I mean,
calcium. There's so much calcium in it. It's just awesome for your bones. As you grow older, you need it. We all do.
And it's full of protein, from what I hear.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, calcium, protein. It's great for your teeth. It's great for your bones.
Did you see my video I did yesterday?
I did not see a video. I went to your page. Did you put it on your Facebook page?
Probably not. It goes on YouTube. Let me show you the linky-dinky to it. I was getting ready to go out for my birthday with my family, and I very often use my webcam as a mirror, you know, to
okay.
do my hair and my face makeup and stuff. And I flipped on my webcam, but I never hit record. And so Heather goes, hit record. No, Victor's the one that goes, hit record, since it's your birthday. So I hit record, and I recorded a little bit of me yesterday getting ready just to remind everybody, see, this is me. This is what I look like. I still look the same. Yeah. Let me give you the link to that. Here it comes right now.
Bloop.
Let's see. Save, copy link location. There we go. And dropping that over here in the chat room comes right here. Kablunk. There we go. That's me yesterday. That's me about 24 hours ago. So there you go.
I didn't get it.
It's in the chat room on Spreaker.com.
Oh, in the Spreaker chat room. I thought you private chatted. I got you. All right.
No, I don't care. In fact, I wish everybody would see it so they can all shut up and say, well, she doesn't Photoshop her pictures. How can you Photoshop a video?
You right? can, but it's incredibly difficult to do. And you have to be really good to be able to do it. So no, people don't do that.
I wouldn't know how to Photoshop a photo, to tell you the truth. I want you to know. Yeah, here it is. I'll hit play, but it's just,
I'm already on it.
It's music.
No, look at me.
It's only 45 seconds long. My hair was wet, so I'm drying my hair but with my hands.
You're fluffing it?
Yeah. I'm talking to Victor, and I haven't done my makeup yet.
Pre-birthday party.
I forgot, no sound.
Talking with Vic.
Talking with Vic. He's standing over to my, on that phone, he's over there to my right. So there I am. And I started to stand up and start dancing around, but you know, to me that's slutty. And just to show, see, I'm not fat, I'm not anything that you say that I am. I'm not decrepit and you know what I mean? Oh, no. It went right to Mr. Midnight Movies.
Yeah. I know. That's why I got rid of it.
I think that is so funny. I think it's cute. It's cute funny. So, let me see if Mr. Midnight Movies is ready to come and talk to us tonight. Let's see where he is. Let me see if I can ring him in. I talked to him earlier, and let's see. I'll just have to gamble that he's out there listening. Now, I have another question for everybody. How do you listen to voicemail on Skype? Does anybody know?
I do.
How?
As soon as you get one, which I've sent you a couple, all you do is there's a little box, a little reel-to-reel recorder. You just click on it.
Well, I got an email that says, you have a voicemail on Skype. And I went over here, and it shows that I have a phone call from a 214 number, but it doesn't show a voicemail. So it would be on my Skype?
Well, what would it would... It should be on your Skype if that's what they called in on. Mm-hmm. And it'll show a little tiny reel-to-reel. And all you would do is click on it, and then it'll play the voice message.
I've
left you a couple.
I've never heard one. I don't know why. Maybe it has trouble getting from Windows to Macintosh or something. Maybe it's a Macintosh thing.
I don't know. I don't know. I believe it's across both of those. So it shouldn't be that issue. Because I know I've left successfully. Your voicemail is long. Your entry... Like when I call you?
What is it me?
It's not you.
Oh, okay. Because I don't even know about
it. It's Mr. Midnight Movie talking with, I believe, JP.
Are
about
you serious?
Some lady parts, yeah.
Okay, so you're being serious.
I swear to God. Yeah, why would I lie to you?
It's Mr. Midnight Movie talking to JP on my voicemail?
I swear to God, that's what you get when I call you. When I want to leave you a message, I have to listen to that for a minute and a half.
Maybe that's why I'm not getting it. Maybe it goes to them or something, because I've never received a voicemail on
Skype. Yeah, and then I know that you've gotten it because I'll look and I'll check my Skype, and it'll show me the little avatar.
It's not me. I haven't got it. Somebody else. I swear to God, somebody else must be getting my voicemails, because and it's got Mr. Midnight Movie and Jewish Producer talking on the message.
Yeah. You'd have to put yourself on do not disturb and call yourself from your cell phone.
No way.
Skype call. Yeah, I guess
that's hysterical. I would have never known that if you hadn't. I wish you would have told me that before. I've never known that.
I thought you knew because it's kind of comical. I thought that you would do that so that way little problem makers would go away because it's kind of long.
What are they saying?
I don't even remember. I don't even listen to it. I just waited for it to end. So, speaking of them.
I'm trying to add him right now, but it doesn't show that he's online on Skype.
I see his image now.
Well, I'm dialing him, but it doesn't show him to be online, so he may not be picking up. Yeah. And I think he's going to call on his phone.
Gotcha.
Okay, let me see if I can do the phone with him. Hold on, because I know he's going to come on and talk to us. Let me see. Add people. I've got his telephone, phone thing. Hold on, let me take a listen and see. This is his phone, I think. Yeah, I think it's going to actually dial his cell phone. See, that's dialing his cell phone. Let me see if he wanted to be, because he said, how about 8:30?
Hello?
Hey, I've called you on your cell phone. Is that cool?
Yeah, it's fine.
Because remember we said 8:30 and it's about 8:35. Are you sure?
Yes. So I was going to try you on another line.
Well, then do that. Hang up.
All right. And then if I can't get through there, I'll call you on this one.
Yeah, just pick back up.
All right.
Bye. Yeah, I never want to get more than two, maybe three people on a show at a time, because if not, everybody just steps all over each other. David's wanting to come in on the call.
Do you want me to drop off and let him come in? It's up to you. However you want to do it.
Now, Steve, isn't that kind of stupid sounding? Do I want you to drop off?
No, I don't mean like die.
Isn't that dumb? If I wanted you to drop off, I would drop you. But no, I'm saying we'll try it, David, but if it starts getting too crowded, then that's absolutely all I'll be taking tonight would be these three. I mean, it's just too many people. And then people start stepping all over each other, and we'll try it. So here comes David. He called two times saying, can I come on the show? So if he's going to answer, I don't know.
Hey,
what's going on, David?
Not much. I didn't expect you to hang up on Steve.
No, I'm still here, buddy. What's going on?
Oh, all right. Not much. Just wanted to call in and say hello and tell everyone I'm still alive and everything.
It's good to know.
Here's Mr. Midnight Movie. Y'all hang on. Hi, yeah. Mr. Midnight Movie. How are you, dear?
How's it going?
Oh, you sound better. Are you on some sort of a... No, I think you're on your cell phone still. Well, anyway, it doesn't matter. You sound great.
I tried to call in on the other phone. I had a landline here, but for some reason it's not working, so...
Did you get the obligatory busy signal?
Yes, I did.
See, and let me check my settings. Watch on Skype. I'll go and check my preferences, and I guarantee you it's going to say under privacy, look... There it is. Receive calls to my Skype number from contacts only. Every time I log off of Skype, it changes.
So it's not you doing it. No,
it's not me doing it. Absolutely not. So it's back now. If you want to hang up and try it again, and I wish you would, hang up and try it again on your other cell, on your other phone to see if it works.
Why is David Lynch and Chris Nelson calling me?
I don't know. They were just calling me, too.
They were calling me, too.
Oh, decline. Oh, what a shame.
That's way too many people on a call. I can't handle it. I just end up going on mute because I can't say a word. I can't get a word in edgewise. Oh, yeah. There goes Mr. Midnight Movie dropping. So, yeah. I think we got it. Did it work that time?
Yeah, it did. Do I come in better on this phone?
You sound wonderful on this phone. Right. Yeah, actually, you do. You sound really good on this phone.
Sorry.
So, hey, guys. I have some topics for this evening. Are y'all familiar with the topics that I opened the show with?
I see the name, What Makes a Person Attractive.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to do three different topics, and Honky the Clown is here. Now, see, every time I say a stupid name, stop it. Where is it? Somebody get in here and get... There. I end up throwing him across the room. Honky the Clown will be determining when we change topics. When you hear Honky Honk, don't. Anyway, then we will be changing topics. So, the topics for this evening are, number one, what makes a person attractive? Number two, I already forgot them. Number two is, can a man and a woman be friends and the man still not want to bang her? And number three, females faking orgasm. What do you think? Y'all on board?
I'm all on board.
I'm on board 100%.
Really?
Yeah.
Mr. Midnight Movie?
Yes, I'm on board. Particularly with the females faking orgasms. It's never happened to me.
You don't think?
I've never faked an orgasm.
No, well, not you. Not you, the female.
I just remember that in the movie Naked Gun when he was breaking up with her and he goes, and by the way, I faked every orgasm.
Are you serious?
It's Leslie Nielsen that said that.
I'm often puzzled by that. How can a man fake orgasm
it was a comedy. He said, by the way.
Oh, he was joking.
Yeah.
It's hard for a man to fake orgasm. Would you not agree?
Well, it's almost impossible.
Right, because there's physical evidence. There's physical evidence of said orgasm, correct?
Whereas with
unless
a female,
you fake the evidence.
Right, unless with except with a female, females can fake the orgasm much better than a male could ever fake it.
Well,
a male
except
can't
that they leave
fake
physical
it at
evidence.
All. Right, the male leaves physical evidence. The woman can, like, scream as loud as possible and say, oh, I've just orgasmed.
She can also scream as high as possible.
God.
No, just let it hang there.
Oh.
You know, when it comes to my own personal experience, which is really all I have, is there is somewhat of a physical evidence whenever I get excited, if you know what I'm saying.
Yep.
Right.
Okay. So I don't see that that's really possible. And having being with the same guy for some many years, I...
Nice. Who did that?
Okay.
Did your sweet little face just accidentally touch the redial button?
Yes, it did.
Bless
his heart.
You do no wrong.
I thought it was the pause button. This phone's kind of new to me.
You do no wrong.
That's a new drop, Deb. That's a new drop.
You do no...
Is it redialing?
You do no wrong with me. You know that.
Okay. It said pause, but okay, I'm sorry.
Don't you sweat it, sweetie. It makes everybody so mad the way I baby him. They hate it.
I think it's funny to a point.
Oh, I love him to death. He just can do no wrong with me. So I have some, since we have spoke last, I have procured some drops from you, said sweetie. Did you hear any of the drops that I have procured off of you the last time we were on the show together? Or one of the shows we did together? Have you heard about those? No? Yes? Maybe
who are you talking to?
Mr. Midnight Movie.
Yeah. Right? Yeah,
Mr. Midnight
Movie.
He's
not answering.
Is he there? Mr. Midnight Movie?
Triple I'm there.
He must be doing something else.
He's fapping.
I got drops off of him, Jewish producer. That it was just such a funny show that there was just, it was really just, it left a lot to
work with for sure.
Yeah. It left a lot to.
That's cool. How now you have more drops to make the show that much better.
Let's take a listen to them. Hang on. Here we go.
Our first show is Chris Nelson. Shut the hell up. I'm sorry. I'm talking with my mouth full. I know I shouldn't, but.
What are you doing with your mouth full? Let's be honest here.
Just I put it on, the, on the comment you put on Facebook, Debbie.
This is a true story. I went to IKEA to go shopping, and I said, we got to get the meatballs. That day, or maybe the next day, IKEA was serving horse meat in their meatballs. So we had eaten horse meat.
Ugh, poor Jewish producer. But when you spoke with your mouthful, that just cracks me up. You don't say that you... The first one... We talk about the fact that your mouth is full, but the second one, it's just so blatantly obvious. Take a listen. Listen. That is so cute.
How is it cute? I want to know.
Well, there goes our first topic. What makes a person attractive? a lot of people think that when it comes to the female, that what makes a man attractive to her is that he's tall, he's handsome, he's got tan, beautiful suntan skin, he's this, and it's not at all, as far as I'm concerned, and many females are concerned. What makes a man attractive is almost, it's in my position, it's 80% personality.
Oh, Debbie, come off it. I'm sorry, but
no.
I have to disagree. I think people pair up as far as looks are concerned.
You obviously don't know me very well because it's
Well, Debbie, you might be an exception to the rule, but it's the horrible...
But that's what I'm saying. I'm saying as far as I go, what I find attractive is the ability to make me laugh, is the ability to have a personality, a sense of humor, to be able to sit and just be somebody. I mean, I cannot stand... I can't imagine being with one of those men that are really good looking, but they have no personality. I mean, they could even treat me perfectly, buy me things, whatever you want to talk about, and I'm just going to get bored to death if they don't have a personality.
What about the badasses out there, like the badass mentality, you know, the tough guy mentality, and how do you feel about the nice guys always finish last?
Message from Jewish Joe.
Well, the way I feel about, give me an example, like an example would be for,
like, let's say if you catch a girlfriend on
No, hang on. I want an example. Okay, I think an example of a badass is on Blog Talk Radio, that guy that goes by the name of Michael Hood.
Mm-hmm.
Are y'all familiar with him?
I'm not.
Well, he's a badass. Mr. Midnight Movie, you know Michael Hood, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I think he's kind of a badass, but I have to get back to the fact, I mean, you have a daughter. Does she have the same perspective as you do? I mean, don't tell me that you didn't like someone that was hideous, you know, that someone who was hideous.
Okay, now what do you call hideous? I mean, if somebody's hideous, I'm not going to be able to touch them. No. My criteria as far as physical features go is skin, teeth, and nails and hair. I mean, you have to have nice teeth, keep your skin has to be nice. I cannot stand the thought of pimples and acne and all that kind of garbage. I think if you're not smart enough to go out to a doctor or get some proactive, then you have no business being with me.
So faces would never,
no.
Pimple-faced fools would never, Prince Charming doesn't have pimples for you.
Well, I think that in this day and age, there's just too much out there to help you out with that.
Yeah.
What about someone with braces or something to fix
their adorable. Teeth? I think it's adorable. Adorable. Simply adorable. Steve, are you there?
What about a man with what about a man with a hairy body?
Like an Italian.
I really, you know, I could overlook it with the personality. I mean, seriously, I would date, okay, for example, let me give you a blatant example of what I'm talking about. We have an attorney friend of ours who probably weighs 340 pounds, okay, of just nothing but fun. But he is the most hysterical, funny, jolly, happy person I've ever been around in my life. And I would...
You know I'm not an attorney. Okay, I'm sorry.
I would not have a problem at all dating him. I would love to date him. And being married as long as I have, Vic and I can think in those lines. I can think of dating and doing something else. But no, seriously, I would have no problem at all dating him. I think he's neat. The funniest guy I've ever been around in my life. Just
but Debbie, what's the consensus you get from your girlfriends or from like your daughter and stuff? Do they follow the same consensus?
My daughter does. My daughter has a friend of hers that stands probably 5'4", 5'3". Mm-hmm. He is presently, don't ask me how, he's in the Marine Corps. And he's gone away overseas in the Marine Corps. She would marry him. Because he is just the neatest thing. He's funny. He's everything. He's just like
treats her well and everything. Like a gentleman.
Women want to be treated well, no matter what they say. They want.
Now, would you date a man who collected cans?
Collected cans. No, I would not date a hobo. You mean a bum on the street? You lost.
What about someone who is disabled?
Meaning like, in a wheelchair?
Yes, or someone who's on public assistance because their disability hinders them from working.
Absolutely, I would date somebody like that. That doesn't mean anything to me. I mean, but I wouldn't date somebody that's on public assistance that's just using the system. Are you kidding me? No, absolutely not. But if somebody's disabled and can't go out and procure employment or a career, absolutely, that's not their fault.
Right, or if they're trying to find a job out there and,
David, do you want to go out with me?
There you go. There's a chance, buddy.
I'm joking.
I already have a girlfriend who I'm happy with, but I consider you like a second mother, though.
Aw, and that's so sweet of you to say. Mother, fuck you, David. I'm joking.
Hey, you're too old. But because my friend, and for a while I thought the idea was crazy,
mm-hmm.
but he believes that on average, you know, people match up as far as looks go, but he said he thinks that more men settle as far as looks go than women do. And, you know, I thought about it, and sometimes when you get desperate out there, you'll go for something, at least have sex with it, that's a little bit less attractive and, you know, not as good looking. And I remember all of those bars that I would go to, and they always would claim that, you know, it was two last call for alcohol. Yeah, two chicks for every dude. And Debbie, mm-hmm. it was never that way. Now, when you attended bar, were there more dudes or more gals?
Guys.
There you go.
Absolutely.
Always more guys. Always.
And what I used to think was so funny is when they would call last call for alcohol, and then they would turn the lights on. You know, to try to get rid of everybody and how ghastly some of those women in there would look.
It's funny.
It's horrible. They'd be like, ugh. You know, what about the girl that's called Coyote Ugly? Do you know what that... Now, let me ask. Do you know what that means, David? Do you know what Coyote Ugly means?
Yeah. Isn't it like with the movie Coyote Ugly and they're like really like well built and everything and they go up on the bar and just start dancing.
No. What Coyote Ugly means is you wake up the next morning from a girl that you've picked up in the bar the night before, and she's laying on your arm. She's asleep on your arm. You would rather chew your arm off than to wake her up.
Yep. Been there, done that.
So she's Coyote.
Oh, so that's a Coyote Ugly.
That's what Coyote Ugly means. You don't want to disturb this monster. You know, I never really had much of a singles life, as you all know, because I stopped this deal somewhat early in life. I mean, I was never single for a long time and out there playing the field, because even if I was young, I just always had a boyfriend, always. And that's kind of the way Heather is, because I've always taught her, real ladies don't date, we have boyfriends, you know.
How long do you tell your daughter to wait until she gets married? Like how long do you tell her to like date someone before she knows it's the right person? Do you tell her that, or do you let her base it off of what she's like?
Well, I don't tell her anything. I mean, she's presently dating somebody that she would love to spend the rest of her life with. So
aww.
We'll see how that goes. And she's mostly concerned with the relationship with her son. And he calls him Daddy Philip. And
aww.
Yeah, it's so cute to listen to him say, Daddy Philip. And it's a cute little threesome, and I hope the best. But no, I don't interfere at all. You know, I would accept anybody that my children dated. You know, I've seen women before that have just made life unbearable for men. Women that marry their children, marry their sons. They've set out to destroy them. And if Stephen married a purple alien, that, you know, I would accept her because the fact that Stephen loves her.
What about a girl who keeps talking about how she wants to have children? What do you think about those types of women?
I would be very careful if I were the man, wouldn't y'all?
I would.
I would be very careful that she's out there just looking for somebody to father children.
Sperm donor.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of those guys, there's a lot of those girls out there.
Yeah. There really are. I mean, more so than you might even think. There are a ton of girls out there that just want to have a kid.
But getting back to the what makes us attractive. Now, let me ask you some questions, Mr. Midnight Movie.
Yes.
Okay. Let's say you meet some... we're going to pretend we're all single tonight.
Okay.
You meet a girl... that is, and me and Mr. Midnight Movie always think in movies, like movies. You meet a girl and she's not very attractive. Well, there's been movies made about this. There was a movie that was, it starred, you know me with my damn names. They were at a beach house all the time and rats. Sandra Hudson, no, her last name is Kate Hudson.
Okay.
Kate Hudson starred in this movie, and it was a situation where there was this good-looking girl that was going to marry this good-looking guy, and her friend comes along, and her friend is not quite as attractive as the friend that he's going to marry, but he just falls madly in love with her because she's more of somebody that he can talk to and laugh with, and would you ever consider, I mean, what?
Yeah, I mean, of course, but... I couldn't marry a woman I didn't find, you know, attractive. That to me is just a woman that would be a friend, because if that person can't arouse me, you know, then what's the point? I mean, I have to be aroused by that woman to be considered a girlfriend or
Absolutely.
Even a wife.
So, 100%. But what about you fall in love with somebody and the fact that you're in love with them is arousing? I mean, it's like...
You have to date
a supermodel? Is that what you're saying?
It doesn't have to be a supermodel, but it has to be someone I'm around that arouses me.
Mm-hmm.
There has to be a physical attraction. There has to be.
Well, that's
I think on the woman's end, too, Debbie. I think women are going to go... I think looks are, if not just as important, important to a woman. I have to say that on average...
Mm-mm.
Okay.
No, I'm not saying that you're wrong. I'm saying as far as I go, you're right. You're wrong. And the reason why it may be, that's why I never just slept with people. I was never a one-night stand, so to speak. I never believed in those things. And I know so many people do. They just picked up women to have sex with them, and they knew they were going to dump them the next day. I just was never into that scene. I must have gone without sex many nights, but I just never thought that was the cool way to go. I guess what you said, the exception to the rule, because I wanted to get to know somebody. Let's say, for example, everybody in the bar that I went out with 10 girls and they were all picking up some guy somewhere over in the corner. You know, it's late, everybody's drinking and everybody's drunk. I was never one of those girls. I was the one sitting at the table with my keys in my hand going, when are we going to go eat? You know, when are we going to get out of here? And they were all wanting to get with these guys.
So you were essentially the cock blocker.
Cock blocker. What does that mean? What do you mean?
Meaning like, you know, like when people are trying to put the make on the chick, you know, like you're going out with your girlfriends and, you know.
To me, sex was meant for love. Sex is not sex. Okay. Sex is
but,
not
but,
an.
But if I'm a single guy and I'm, you know, you reject me, you don't want to have sex with me, but I might be getting lucky with this one girl,
mm-hmm.
you know, one of your friends.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, come on, we got to go to dinner after drinks.
Oh,
like,
no. I was never like that. In fact,
I would hate you.
No. No. Don't get me wrong. I lived with a girl that was always on the take. We went out, she was with somebody different. And it was really gross in my book. I don't know. I just.
So she played hippity hop, basically, from guy to guy to guy.
Oh, it was ridiculous. It was every night, somebody else, every night. And it was. I mean, I would wake up some mornings and walk out and look in the living room and go, oh, hi, I didn't know you were here. You know, hey, how are you?
Wow.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah. And waiting for her to get out of the shower to go take him home or whatever. And it was just really a really sick setup that was going
on. Sounds awkward.
Well, I never.
Did you regret it?
Oh, absolutely. I thought it was.
So you're saying she regretted like hopping from man to man?
I don't know. I would. I just took sex very seriously. And if I'm going to go, to me, when I had anybody I had sex with, I had already been out with them several times. I knew them as a friend. It was somebody that I know that I'd grown to be very attracted to or something. It was not just, hey, you look good. Let's go do it. That to me was just really sick behavior.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. It just was. And I know there's a lot of people that are going to disagree, but I think it was gross. I took my body very seriously.
So you consider your body as a temple and you
want it. Well, I think we all should. I mean, I think if.
Yes, I think so too.
It's gross. I mean, I think that's like animal behavior out in the forest. Just, I mean, I'm probably pissing a couple of people off on the board here. Steve, you're quiet.
No, I'm just letting everybody that's talking, so I'm not trying to be rude. That's all. I'm listening.
Well, it's not like we're at a tea party. It's not being rude. You just talk. You have to interrupt. If you don't, you'll never get to, you'll just sit there all night and not say a word.
Oh, I know how to do this.
So I'm saying, but I think it's gross. I think that kind of behavior is sick. Just to meet somebody. Hi, I'm Debbie. Hi, I'm Steve. Would you like to dance? Sure, I'd love to. Would you like a drink? Sure, let's go get a drink. You know, drink. So you want to go to my place? No, are you kidding me?
It happens so fast, though. Jesus.
Well, what kind of a woman does that?
A whore?
Someone that's drunk enough that, you know, you get them drunk enough and you say, oh, you want to come back to my place? She'll more than likely say, sure.
That is so gross.
But some women have different views on sexuality and have different, men are hardwired that way on average. You're the rule on that, and your friend was the exception.
Are you sure it wasn't the other way around? She was the rule and I was the exception?
Yeah. That's what I meant.
You know what? I got to say, I could be wrong on that. I would always think that you were the rule. You would be the rule. Most girls are cling to their body and sluts are, you know.
Well, let me ask y'all something. If you would have gone out with me back when I first got home from Lubbock, okay, mm-hmm. That's the only time in my life I ever remember being single. And I would go out with guys. I met a guy one night at a bar and just fell in love with the guy. He was about, he's like 5'11", probably 280 pounds. He was chubby. He had a pretty face, but he was cute. He went to the University of North Texas. Okay. He lived in Denton. And I gave him my number thinking I'm never going to hear from this guy. I didn't do anything with him, just said goodnight at the bar and went home. The next day, my phone rings. I'll never forget this. And he says, hey. I go, hey. And by the way, his name was Steve. He goes, hey, what's going on? And he said, do you want to spend the day together? I thought we could go have lunch. I said, sure. So he drives all the way from Denton, picks me up at my house where I live with some sorority sisters in Dallas. Comes over there, picks me up. I lived off Greenville Avenue. Picks me up. Then we go have a great lunch or brunch, whatever you want to call it, spin. And then we just kind of go driving around. And he says, do you want to go up to the University of North Texas and I'll show you the campus? I said, sure, let's go. Go up there, go to his fraternity house where he lived, you know, Kappa Kappa, whatever. Go in. They're like, hey, I meet all the guys. Go up to his room. And the guy starts to try to have sex with me.
And?
What do you expect, Debbie?
And I said, excuse me, this isn't going to happen. This isn't an extension from last night. I don't do this. Took me home, never heard from him again.
Wow, what a moron, you know? It's like, no offense, but that's just piggish on his part, you know?
It's like, pretty typical, though. It's pretty typical.
Yes, it is.
Okay,
yes,
I'll tell you about another one that happened. Met a guy at a bar. This is a true story, swear to God. Met a guy at a bar, fell in love with him, thought he was the cutest thing I'd ever seen. He goes back to Lubbock, Texas the next week, that next day. It was a Saturday night when I met him. He goes back. flies back the next weekend to see me again. This was a time when I had come back from Lubbock. I was living with my brother and my sister-in-law at the time, okay? Living there at their house because I hadn't got my own place yet. Well, he comes over there, picks me up, takes me to the State Fair of Texas, okay? We have a blast at the State Fair of Texas. He was staying at a hotel not too far from my brother's house. Go over to the hotel with him. He was a perfect gentleman over there. Everything was great. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. About 2 weeks go by, and he asks, can he fly me to Lubbock? I said, great. Now, y'all tell me if this is me or him.
Okay, keep going.
Okay. He flies me to Lubbock. I remember when he picked me up at the airport. He took me to my hotel. I remember staying at this so-and-so lodge in Lubbock, Texas. Stayed there. Everything was great. He took me to a party that night where we went over to the Air Force base. There was a place where we could have parties over there. They had a party. He was in a fraternity, blah, blah, blah. One thing leads to another. And he tries some stuff on me the second night I'm there, and I'm due to go back the next day. And I said, I don't do this.
So was it about 3 dates, you would say? The first time you met him, then you spent 2 days?
No, gosh, this was probably 7 or 8 dates into it. I mean, wow.
I don't think he was inappropriate.
But see, that's what I'm trying to say. At what point does the guy say, then fuck you?
Some girls have the, 3-date rule. You know, it's 3 dates. If they're good, solid 3 dates.
I had the relationship rule. I had not established that I was his girlfriend yet.
Yeah.
And I just, that's the way I looked at it. And I'm wondering, is that wrong?
No.
Everybody has to do it on their own time. And everybody has to do it at their own pace. Otherwise,
but
they're not going
to become. I lost a lot of potential suitors over this. And I'm wondering, if I would have slept with the guy, is that the requisite for staying with somebody?
No.
You could also got herpes. You could also got some disease, too. You didn't. So
syphilis, gonorrhea, yeah.
Mr. Midnight Movie, what do you think about that, though? I mean, here the guy had flown down, took me to the State Fair of Texas, paid for all this. Then he goes back 2 weeks later. He flies me on Southwest Airlines back out to Lubbock. I mean, I know that I anguished over this for years thinking, because this guy was really something else. He was amazing.
Mr. Chance with me, Debbie.
Was that you?
Then again, you wouldn't have met Victor, though.
Well, I think that was in the cards. But the thing about it are there girls out there that are blowing chances with guys because they want, would y'all do that? And don't say you wouldn't just because you're trying to sound good.
I would think that I've established and we're comfortable and we're laughing, we're having a good time and we're hitting it off. 7 dates in, I believe we should be having sex.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Particularly if I'm buying you good dinners.
Has nothing to do with what I'm buying. But I mean, it should be part of it.
So, Mr. Midnight Movie.
I usually wait about maybe a good 6 months to see how it's going.
Wow.
Then.
Oh, my God.
Do that because
I'm going to the strip club after the date.
Well,
no. No,
go ahead,
David.
Well, because what if it's not the right person and you've just had sex with someone and they've left you and treat you like complete shit afterwards and saying, oh, this was the most awful sex I've ever had in my life, this and that, instead of waiting and enjoying it.
Well, as a man, a lot of times, testicles get filled with semen. And,
please, that's too much information. No, I'm saying, so too many men in this country or in this culture, they either say, give up the booty or they get the boot.
I don't think it's 100% that way because I know women that.
Well, now, wait a minute. Wait. You just said that. You just said that, Steve. You just said after 7 dates, either you give it up or you're gone.
I'm talking about me personally, yeah.
That's what I said.
Not that you're gone, but I would expect it to be normal. I would think you asked me what I thought. And for me, 7 solid dates and chemistry is perfect and everything's good, I would believe in seven full dates.
What about you just met Miss
– What if she's a virgin?
We're not talking about that, Angel. What about if you just met Miss Morals? What about if there's some people left in this world that have morals?
Then it would be worth it. Oh, my God, it would be worth it.
If you only live once. As an atheist, you only live once. Want to do something that feels good.
Well, I don't care about God or not. I have morals as a human that I wasn't going to just use my body here, you know, trash my body out, and then if you don't like me, throw me away. I no. Hell no.
That's the difference, and that's the one difference between men and women, because men don't look at it as trashing their body. They look at it as a release. You know, men get aroused, they want a release. I guess women don't, or at least more women than men look at it the way you look at it.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah. I didn't meet many women like me. They were pretty much all whores. They were always banging somebody. I mean, I just don't see it that way. It's like, to me, that's animalistic behavior. Not the way Mr. Midnight Movie said it, but to me, I mean, what separates us from the animals is the fact that we just...
Not very much.
Well, bullshit!
Am I not?
I'm not an animal. I am somebody with high morals, and God damn it, I was not going to be just... Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. And I think maybe now y'all know all these years on the air, I'm not bullshitting y'all when I said I didn't have sex with anybody. I didn't. I graduated a virgin. Not too long.
I'm going with the majority of girls. You know what I do for a living. You know the girls that I know. In the scenes that I'm at, those girls will sleep with you the first day they meet you.
Well, most girls will.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Most girls nowadays, if they don't sleep with you in person, they're on a webcam taking off their...
Showing it all, yeah.
They're texting you over text.
Hold on, guys. Let me finish my sentence here. Okay, listen to me. They're on the goddamn webcams sticking dildos in every orifice that they can show the camera on. Are you kidding me? My mind does not go there. My mind doesn't go there. I mean,
That's good.
Well, I'm not trying to do this to get props. I could care less what somebody thinks, but I'm just telling you the truth. My mind does not go there. I cannot fathom doing that to somebody that I don't even know.
Yeah. That sounds like a porn star, more like.
It's a whore. It's a piece of shit whore that has no business mothering children or anything. There, I said it. I said it.
And that's so true.
Would one of y'all marry one of them?
God, no.
No.
I believe in open relationships, so, you know, I really could care, you know.
Well,
I don't.
But, so, is there any time at all, Mr. Midnight Movie, that you would profess your, what is that? What would that be called?
Your love?
No, profess your whatever to me that you
my libido or my
whatever that would be called. I don't know how you would word that.
Your true feeling,
my chastity for just them. Or
exactly,
my,
exactly.
Probably not. I don't. You know, I don't believe in that stuff.
What do you mean you don't believe in that stuff? That's the stuff life is made out of.
Not well. That is for most people, but for me.
So if you would you ever get married?
Sure.
Okay, so you would go around.
But it would be, you know, like getting married to me, you know, is like, you know, between two people. But it doesn't mean that I wouldn't. Getting married for me doesn't mean that I would, or for her, I believe in open relationships.
So if you came home from work one day, let's say that I was that woman, and I was saying, bye, I'll see you later, Dan, and there's some man walking out the door, you wouldn't say a word. Really?
I would be curious.
I don't believe that.
You know what? Hey, I'm not like most men, though. You know, 99.9% of men would have a problem. I could give a shit less.
Let me say this: if you got married, that means you fell in love with her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you knew another dude was touching her, you'd lose your effing mind. You could say what you want now, but the fact is, you'd lose your effing mind. You'd want to kill him.
Do you believe in love, Mr. Midnight Movie?
What's that?
Do you believe in love?
Sure.
So if you were in love with me, if you fell head over heels in love with me, which you probably would, most of them did, you would still screw around behind my back.
Well,
that's what I thought.
I would make it known that
But there would come a point in time where you wouldn't want to hurt me. You wouldn't even want to know.
No, I would not. Right. I would not do it behind your back. I would. I would just say, you know, I would make it clear that this is going to be an open relationship or it's not going to be a relationship at all.
Wow. Then you'll never get married, man, because I was married twice and I was completely faithful, 100,000,000%. I would never cheat on anybody I've ever been with, ever.
I don't consider it cheating because I didn't make a commitment saying that I would be faithful only to them or she did it with me. So long as I don't catch a disease, I really don't care.
Well, that's inevitable if you're both.
I don't think you've ever been in love.
Yeah, I don't think so.
No,
well, I've been in love, but
once you find true love, you will think differently. You know,
I have been in love.
Okay.
And my philosophy about love is I want it, but I don't need it.
Right, but we're not going there. I'm saying, have you ever truly been in love? And if you were in love to this sweet little angel, you would have no problem going out and banging somebody behind her back.
Well, I would never do it behind her back, but...
Well, if she's a real woman...
Okay, Debbie, when I was younger, I fell in love. I had infatuation, yada, yada, yada. At this age, I don't have any of that. Those feelings are done.
No, I don't believe that.
Okay, well...
Do you have a human heart. You have a human brain.
You've
obviously got the ability to... Help me out here, Steve.
I think, okay, this girl that you were in love with... Mm-hmm. At the time, let's go backwards a little bit. You were in love with her. Could you imagine another guy having sex with her?
No, not at that time, but now
okay.
I don't care.
Because you were in love with her. But if you fell in love again, like you were back then, mm-hmm. you would feel the same way, I believe, in my humble opinion.
Yeah, I mean, my mentality has changed from...
You seem very jaded. You seem very jaded towards a relationship and towards love and all that.
What happened? Something must have happened. You must have really got hurt.
You know, what? I don't know. I considered myself more, you know, and I guess on this issue, I consider myself a little bit more evolved on the issue. I believe
evolved. That's wait.
I'll be honest with you.
You think that's where this clicked in? Go ahead.
When Roy Masters said, "You should want a woman's love as a grown man. You should never need a woman's love. You should want it." But never need it, because you'll give in to things you shouldn't give in to.
Wow.
I honestly don't see where you're coming from. I don't.
I'm saying that you know, it doesn't... The thing is, those things don't make me, you know, like the thought of another man touching my woman doesn't make me crazy.
Because you don't have it. You've never had that.
Who says?
You. I mean, I hate to make this about Mr. Minette movie, but I think this is paramount here. This is amazing. I've never come up across this before in my life. So basically, you're just statuesque. You're just a human without any emotion then.
What's the longest relationship you've ever been in?
Dave, he didn't get a chance to respond to what I said. Well, damn it.
Oh, my bad.
Okay. Statuesque. No emotion. Oh, well, can you answer the question one more time? Because I got David's question, and then
I said, so basically, you become statuesque. You have no emotion. You have no emotion. Yeah, I'm going to stand on that.
You know, I look at it from a different perspective. You know, all those emotions are there, but I try not to let them control me. Emotions of jealousy, and you know, there are plenty of swingers out there who, you know, have, you know, relationships, you know, have husband and wives relationships, but still, you know, sex is, monogamy is not part of the equation.
Wow. It's very interesting. You do realize that sex is not everything and that you have to grow old with somebody and you should certainly want more than just a piece of ass. I mean, there's so much more to this than what you're saying. I mean, I understand what you're saying about, you know, needing it. I'm a man. I know what you're saying. I get you there 100%. But if I fell in love with somebody, I started dating. Once I officially am dating someone, there's no one else that I can conceivably think of touching because I've gone to that emotion with her.
Mm-hmm.
And now she should feel the same way. If she cheats on me, I'm gone. There's never a second chance. Even the thought of somebody else touching what I believe to be mine and hers, I'm part of her too. Mm-hmm. Anybody touching that or violating that is just wrong.
I agree with you, Steve, you know, because it's like once you get emotionally attached to someone, it's like a whole different aspect of the relationship. And when it starts to get touching, feeling sexual and everything, then, and if you find out the woman cheats on you or touches another man, that's like you feel hurt and violated. Like, I poured my heart out to you and all you did, and this is how you repay me?
Yeah. I 3M, let me ask you this.
Yes.
And it's kind of repeating it, but I think you're going to fall in love. I think that you will. I think that this whole philosophy that you have going on is because you're not there now. Mm-hmm. And you're kind
message
of
from
pissed
Andy
off.
Bong.
Can I step in here for 1 second?
Absolutely.
Andy Bong just sent me a message on Skype that says, hey, can I come on the show? And I answered, no, you're a mean person. He is. He set me up. He ambushed me.
It was an ambush.
You know what? Okay. You're right. You're right on that. He did. I just, yeah.
No.
Okay.
He doesn't talk
okay.
to me at all, so.
When he wants to bend over and say, I'm sorry, I realize the error of my ways, perhaps we'll consider it. But no, I draw the line on certain things. Now, before I wouldn't do that, I would say, sure, come on. But I'm tired of being the pushover that anybody can do anything to and then just come right back
message
on.
Message from Jewish Joe.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. I don't blame him.
Message from Andy Bong.
And I stand on that. So no, you will not come on the show. You know, I mean, he ambushed me with that woman, and it was horrible what I went through. And
please
people just
up.
Take feelings for
and
granted.
Wrong.
They take my feelings for granted. I've got feelings. I'm a real person. I have feelings. I got hurt. That was bad. That was wrong. That was horrible. And Andy Bong, you owe me the apology. I don't care about your, as Bathtub Girl said, your diminished capacities, whatever the hell that means. You don't have diminished capacities. You're no better or worse than I am. You know exactly what I'm saying. You apologize publicly and we'll consider it. Go ahead. So I was thinking about something. Y'all go right ahead. I was thinking about something and I'm trying to remember what it was. It was an article I read.
Okay, 3M, I guess, all right, so let's say this girl that
and I still had, love him. Nobody, that's never going to change. Nothing will ever change Mr. Midnight Movie.
Okay.
He's just too adorable. If I had a shot at him, I bet I could change him. You've just never met the right woman, Mr. Midnight
that's
Movie.
Bingo, that's exactly what it is.
Ding, 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 what's the prize?
Yeah, once you meet that girl that makes your toes curl, dude, it's over. She owns
Let me
you,
just
man.
Say this.
And she's you know, good to you. Loyalty will come to you.
To me, there are plenty of girls that can make your toes curl. I think that for me, and I think a lot of men may even start to think this way, if you don't need a woman's love, they don't have any power over you anymore.
What's
and that's
the power
have too.
To do with it? I'm sorry. I don't understand where it comes to power. I mean,
I hear I'm scared to death.
Man, there's a lot of fear in that.
There's a lot of fear in that. You're scared to death of needing anything.
Well, there are very few things in life that I need. Food, shelter, and cooperation. And I do need people's cooperation. But their love, you know, if someone loves me, they love me for the kind of person I am, and they treat me with respect. You know, and I treat them with mutual respect.
Right.
If somebody doesn't have that, then why the hell should I try to need someone's love whose love isn't worth spit?
Well, then that isn't the person you should be with.
Yeah. But I'm talking about anybody in general. Like there are you know, when you're young, when you're a young kid and through your adolescence, you need acceptance, you need friendship. And as you grow older, I think you should need less of it.
I hear the word need too much in the equation. Need, 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 need. I just think that you've never been in love. You've never been smitten as an adult.
Oh, I've been smitten. I've had infatuation.
How deep?
Mr. Midnight Movie, what's wrong with you? I just want to say, what's wrong with you?
Okay, let me turn the tables on you. Let me ask you a question.
Me or Steve?
Steve. Now, let me ask you a question. Have you ever, like, was there ever a girl that got away that you just, like, you know, you think, you know, like, that was just gorgeous, but didn't, wasn't interested in you, or...
Yeah, well, you get over it.
Yeah, there was. Sorry. And I still, to this day, okay, this happened when I was 16, 17 years old. To this day, I still miss her.
Oh, get over
it. I swear to... Debbie, I've said it. I said
it. Are you fucking kidding me? Get over it.
There's this one girl I just completely was in love with. I did not sleep with, by the way.
Wah, fucking wah. Are you kidding me? Oh,
I didn't
get over it.
Wait.
I still love that girl.
Fuck is that shit? I'm sorry.
She was amazing. She was just... She was an amazing girl.
She must have been really hot.
She was very attractive.
I had
but physically, I mean, you
she just had the character of like 10 different people. She was like, she's just a really beautiful person, you know? And I thought I'd never find a girl like that again, and I never have.
Yeah.
I've had the same thing. I went to a school dance in high school. I went with one girl thinking she was my girlfriend, and I come out of the bathroom and she's busy kissing on some other guy.
Well, that's not good. No. I dated this girl for six and a half months. Okay? To this day, you can ask my brother.
Six and a half months, 3 days, 4 hours, and 15 seconds?
I do. And her name is Elaine. And you can ask my brother. I swear to God, I'll see something. I'll say, yeah, that's something Elaine would like. He'd be like, would you fucking stop it?
Are you kidding me?
He says, are you kidding me? Really? Even though I've been married a couple times, I have kids, I've dated hundreds of girls. He's like, really? Still her? I'm like, really? Because she was the perfect girl. I let her get away.
How did you let her get away? Did she walk out or what?
No, well, we were both young. Her father hated me. I told you this story a long time ago.
I don't remember.
Her father hated me. He worked for the city of Chicago as a truck driver.
Why did her father hate you?
Because I was older than her. I was a couple years older than her. So she was like 14, 15. She just turned 15. And I didn't want to have sex with her. He says, don't ever have sex with my daughter because I'll kill you. I'll put you in the back of the garbage truck and I'll crush you. So I was afraid, and I really didn't want to have sex with her. She was just too sweet. She was too perfect.
I'd be in the back of that garbage truck.
So you never even had sex with her?
No, like we went like the third base. Like that's as far as we went. And
I know, but I didn't finish my question. I said, you never even had sex with this woman, and yet she has been on your mind all these years?
All these years, to this very minute. I'll be honest. You wanted me to be pure and honest. I'm being 100% honest. I went back 3-4 years ago to the house where she grew up, and her brother was my best friend, Danny. God, if she's listening to this, Stan, will I be feeling like shit?
But, she's not listening, I can assure you. Go ahead.
Okay. But yeah, I went back and I'm like, Danny, you know, how's Elaine doing? He's like, well, you know, she's married now. She has 3 kids. He's like, he knew how I felt about her. He always knew. He's like, too bad it wasn't you, huh? I'm like, yeah, too bad. And I just left.
All right. On that note, we're going to take a quick break for 3 minutes and 44 seconds. This is where I take control of my show, like you said earlier. Take control. I wanted to play this song and dedicate it to Mr. Midnight Movie. And we will be right back at the end of this song. We're going to pick right back up where we left off, guys. We'll be right back.
Just win.
We are back. Deb, are you there?
I barely made that.
Great song.
Yeah, dedicated to Mr. Midnight Movie. Love and Touch and Squeezing by Journey.
Okay.
So did you feel anything when that song was playing, Mr. Midnight?
Were you crying?
Yeah, I was bawling like a baby.
Were you eating a meatball sub to it?
I was watching Two Girls, One Couple. That was playing it.
Ew.
Just kidding.
Ew. There's nothing wrong with two girls having fun.
Yes.
Scatology. Completely normal. Completely normal.
But Getting back to the point about attractiveness, mm-hmm. I have to say that Debbie is not the norm.
Attractive.
No, Debbie is not. In my opinion, Debbie, your view is not the norm of most women. I think most women
are flaccid and self-absorbing gold diggers.
I think
I think when women are younger, definitely they're just as, on average, they're just as shallow as men, I guess. I don't know why you call that shallow, but they're just as look conscious as men. As they grow older, they look for a man who's able to take care of things, you know, and able to make money.
I think that's fair.
To me, the most important thing is a man that I can love, that is a good man, a good, decent man, a good man. And a good man to me is just, if it's raining outside and we're living out in the streets, he's going to go find shelter. You know, it's a man that will be a man. What is a man? What is a man? Define what a man is, Mr. Midnight Movie. What is a man to you? What is a man's purpose on this planet?
His purpose on, for me,
not for you. Just tell me. Don't question the question.
For a man,
just answer the question. What is a man?
Basically, to serve man. I mean, to be part of mankind.
I just saw a little peeky poo around the corner from Mr. Solution.
Ooh.
See, I have my Skype set up to where I get visual notification.
Message from MR. Solution.
Dum ta dum tum tum. Well, I was getting some Swiss cheese. I meant to ask y'all, does Swiss cheese always have to have holes in it? Like we call it mouse cheese.
Yes.
Yes.
Because I got some Swiss cheese from the delicatessen where they slice it up in front of you, you know? Mm-hmm. Because the baby likes to watch the slicing machine. But it doesn't have holes in it.
Does it have little tiny ones, though? Little tiny micro ones?
No.
Then it's not Swiss cheese.
That's what I thought. What makes holes in mouse cheese, you wonder?
It's aging. It's the amount of oxygen that's in the cheese.
Well, let's take a look and see what Mr. Solution says. He says, hi, Debbie. Are you taking Skype calls? Well, yes, I am. Of course. But I don't want any arguing and fussing. But this is an interesting topic, and we're going to chew this up every which way we can and spit it out, right? No, stop. He's back. Hold on. What?
Debbie, I feel a man is someone who buys flowers for a woman when they're least expecting it.
Leave him alone.
Honky agrees.
No, Honky's disagreeing. Yeah. Honky's wanting to change the subjects right now. Honky, stop.
Oh, okay.
He's saying that stop. Hold on just a second. Hold on.
You killed the Honky.
That's throwing him across the room.
He's a sad
clown. Now he's whining. Stop it. Anyway.
So stupid.
One more peep out of you.
And I'm going to bust your big red bulb on there, whatever it is. So, Mr. Midnight Movie, do you ever... Yes. I'm enthralled. I'm intrigued.
Okay.
I am not being prompted for contact, Mr. Solution says. What does that mean? I'm not being prompted for contact. Oh, one moment, please. He wants to come in and join the call. Y'all be nice, everybody. Be nice and play nice. He'll be nice.
Of course.
But nobody pick on anybody else. Everybody.
I hope not.
No. So I'm intrigued by this. Do you ever watch a movie that makes you cry? Hi, Mr. Solution. How are you, dear? Oh, he has to get his thing set up. Do you ever watch a movie that makes you cry, Mr. Midnight Movie?
I mean, it put a lump in my throat.
I'm trying to decide if you are without emotion, I guess is where I'm going.
Yeah.
I'm a person, you know, who has emotion, but I also believe that people should not always emote all of their emotions.
Emote emotion.
I love that.
So what is it that brings your emotion out? What brings emotion to the surface for you? What is it? There's got to be something.
Child abuse?
Everybody has to have
emotion. Well, I'll tell you what brings, and it's usually anger. Sometimes love and sometimes kindness, but, you know, the biggest emotion I probably have is anger. If I feel mistreated or something's unfair, that will bring out my anger.
Well, the reason I inquire as to the emotion aspect of it is I'm wondering if somebody is feeling like you're feeling, do you not have emotion for anything? I mean,
I have angry emotions.
Are you cutthroat? I mean, would you run over a dog and that not bother you? Or, you know what I'm talking about?
No. I mean, if I felt someone was unfair,
mm-hmm.
I don't know if this is, you know, the only thing that stops me, like, I mean, there was a guy who I felt wronged me, and the only thing that stopped me from doing him in was the law. Because I, you know, but am I that, you know, would I run over a dog and not, I mean, I certainly would feel bad if I accidentally ran over a dog or hurt somebody innocent. But, I don't know. I don't think I'm without emotion. I do the right, and my feelings, I guess, help me discern what is right and what is wrong.
Because I think I sense a person that has been hurt by love and is not wanting, you know, I'm not going to love anymore, you know, and I know that there's men that do that.
I guess that may be kind of true because, I have been hurt, but what's wrong with protecting yourself and saying, you know, I'm not going to let this kind of thing hurt me anymore. Just
nothing.
You know,
there's nothing wrong with that at
what's
all.
What's wrong? Because to me, when you're, you know, as a child, you get upset over everything, and as you grow into adulthood, less things should upset you. That's the mark of adulthood, in my opinion.
Right, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. To always protect yourself, and you need to do that. People should do that more often than to just jump into another relationship. But I believe where you're at is so far away from that. Like you're almost desensitized to love. And like you wouldn't even allow it in just for the fear of it. And you said even if you did, and you were in a relationship, that if cheating was in, cheating would have to be part of it.
Well, I mean that's, you know,
that's pretty.
Know.
It's pretty.
I mean,
that's pretty scary. That you would feel that way. I mean, something really happened, dude. There had to be something seriously deep down in your emotion that desensitized you so far to the point there you could see your girl having sex with another guy and being cool with it, and she being cool with you doing it.
Yeah, it wouldn't bother me.
Again, I think that's one of those things where you say it, but you don't mean it. I'm not saying.
Well, on Saturday Night Live, I think you're blocking Vito. They were talking to Vito in The Godfather. He goes, "Oh, and by the way, they shot my son 54 times. I think you're blocking Vito." You know, it's where he was acting like Mr. Midnight Movie. He was like, you know, the SPC's on me about this horse thing. I got the IRS after me, you know. And then he goes, oh, and by the way, they shot my son 54 times. You know, just sort of a by the way thing, you know. And they were trying to get to the point to where he was really upset about his son being killed. But anyway, Mr. Solution, welcome to the show. How are you, dear? Are you there? I still don't hear him. He's on the call. He shows to be on, live and on the call, but I don't hear him, I guess.
Yes.
Maybe. There he goes.
Am I there?
There you are. You're,
am I here?
You're here.
Am I everywhere?
You are here.
You're everywhere if you're here.
Hey, welcome on board.
How is everyone?
We're good. We're good. We're very good. We're doing a show tonight on what makes a person attractive. We took a little bit of a turn earlier when someone on the panel said, I could never be faithful, and I would never want anybody to be faithful to me. And we all kind of were taken back by that. And he's standing his ground on it and saying that he does not believe in chastity, so to speak, or you know, anything along those lines. And we're kind of perplexed, to be honest with you.
Well, yeah, that is perplexing because that's all inherently contradictory.
Yeah, that's what we were thinking. But, and he knows I would never pick on him, and I would never pick on him. I find it a little perplexing that somebody, you know, I'm like, so if I were to meet you and let's say Victor died a fiery death in a car crash or, you know, very, very, very painful death. No,
well,
I'm joking.
Let's not take it out like that.
I'm joking.
Really?
Okay, go ahead.
And I'm suddenly single and Brian says, oh, we'll fly out here and spend the weekend with me and Jewish producers. Great. And he meets me and he's just like, whoa, you already love me as a friend because we've been friends. And you see me and you're like, this is unbelievable. I love her to death. I'm in love, Jewish producer. I'm in love. And if you think for 1 minute that I'm going to open the floodgates and let you just go have a rah-rah hoo-hoo with anybody that you feel like, you're dead wrong. And I'm not going to either.
Would you ever go to a swingers party with me?
Oh, my God, I'm going to throw up. Are you kidding me? No, of course, that's insidious.
It's established that humans are not naturally monogamous, so you would never go to a swingers
ball. Now, are you quoting somebody, or do you honestly feel that way?
Well, no, Stabby said that.
Oh, Stabby.
Humans are not naturally monogamous.
Well, no, animals are not naturally monogamous. Like Gunner.
Are we animals?
Gunner would do. Well, we are not animals. We are above the animal kingdom. We have what's called morals. We're not. I mean, Fufu would go have sex with Gunner, then turn around the next day have sex with little man. I mean, she doesn't know any better. But we as humans have what's called morals. We have, I need words here, people. We have morals. We have
values. There's values.
Yeah.
We're not animals. And
there's a moral compass that you have to have. And if you don't have that moral compass, you're lost.
Well, that's why I said earlier that's almost like animalistic behavior to me. Before we even talked about Mr. Midnight Movie.
Yeah,
I think I used to think that girls that would just go pick up guys in the clubs and go home, and it was like an animal.
What do you think of married couples that practice swinging?
They're not married couples. They're taking the sanctity of marriage and spitting
at it. Abusing it.
Yeah, okay. They're basically, it's like they're basically thinking the marriage is just a piece of paper instead of really going off of what true marriage is.
David, they're making a joke out of it. The sanctity of marriage is for two people, right? I know Mr. Solution is chomping at the bit to say something. Are you going to say something? Yes?
Well, I certainly can, but I was just listening to you guys work through it. You know, I always enjoy that.
Right.
But no, excuse me?
No, I just, okay. I'm going to challenge you to not start any sentence tonight with the words Brian.
What is that?
but seriously, so these people who decide to be together and, you know, love each other and, you know, share a home together, but like they go out and they participate in swinging.
The wedding vow, sir, let me interrupt you and say, here's the wedding vow. I, Debbie, take you, Brian, to be my lawfully wedded husband through sickness and in health, through for rich or for poor, forsaking all others until death do we part.
Okay.
Well, there's the issue of definition, and there is none based on what 3M is saying. I discussed this once. I was talking about open marriage, and open marriage is an expression of a refusal to grow up. If you want an open marriage, just stay single.
Don't get married.
Exactly.
Yeah, what you're doing is you're confusing and perverting the terms. Marriage is a traditional institution that is monogamous, that is faithful.
It says forsaking all others.
Absolutely.
Okay, what about an open relationship?
That's not a relationship.
There's no such thing.
That's not
the marriage.
That's an oxymoron. That's an oxymoron. That's like saying open a closed can, drinking out of a closed can of soda pop.
Right. It's a perversion is what it is. And, of course, some people live at that level who do have standards in this area. Now, I've noticed that people do have standards. The most warped person has standards. It's just where they choose to apply them. and apparently they don't choose to. At least what Brian, what 3M is saying in this particular context, he is avoiding applying the standards by definition. Marriage is an exclusive relationship.
I refuse to believe it. I refuse to believe, and not anybody on this panel can convince me, that if Brian and I were to meet and fall in love, that he would not get upset if I, which I wouldn't, if I were to have relations with somebody else. I refuse to believe it.
So you wouldn't have that swinging relationship. Say if something happened to Victor, you wouldn't have that swinging relationship with me.
How many times can I say this? Okay, I'm going to put it real easy. No. Are you kidding? That's not a relationship, Mr. Midnight Movie. It's not.
I think what he's expressing, he doesn't value commitment.
Do you, sir?
My definition of commitment includes, like, I would only love, I mean, I would have a special love for her and she would have a special love for me, but it doesn't mean that we don't have, you know, that we wouldn't want to, you know, sample, you know, I mean, my favorite dish is cheeseburger, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to want that every night.
Yeah, but that doesn't make any sense. Oh, go ahead. Had you finished?
Yeah, I finished. Yeah,
that doesn't make any sense. That doesn't make any sense because, number one, you're not talking about a cheeseburger. You're talking about something of infinitely more value. I mean, you can substitute food, but you can't substitute a person that you've made a commitment. So your error is confusing the infinite value of a human being with a cheeseburger.
Well, I guess that was perhaps a bad analogy.
It was a bad analogy.
Okay.
Indeed.
But, I mean, can't you love someone and still, you know, both of you fulfill other carnal desires? You don't believe that?
It's certainly not meritable. You can't marry someone and have that philosophy because then you would not have a true marriage. I mean, if you want to still be single, then still stay single and just hang out with that person. But to go into the sanctitude of marriage and believe that that's the way to do it, I could promise you that you only end up in one place, and that's divorce court.
Yeah, Mr. Midnight Movie, I don't know one woman out there that is going to take – I got Fufu's hair in my mouth. Damn it, she jumped up here. She jumped up here and got it all over my shirt, and it flew in the air. It's like
Have either of you ever talked to swingers?
I don't have anything to say to swingers. To me, they're grotesque humans.
But you said that's
they're animals. Brian, that is animalistic behavior. Oh, I'm going to go here and bump, bump, bump with you, and then fuck you, and then fuck you, and then, oh, give me. That's animalistic behavior. That's not a human to me. That is somebody that's just, they're like a machine or something. It's gross.
Because it's all for one thing. It's just for getting off. There's no other value there. There's no love. There's no heart.
Something's wrong.
There's no emotion. You know, sex is fine. Sex is wonderful. I love it. You should do it until you fucking are sore.
And let me that's too much information. But I'm saying that sex with my husband is off the charts. I mean, I guarantee you it's more than any single person out there within the sound of my voice has had. I mean, it's crazy. But you have to know how to do it. I mean, you have to know what's going. You have to know, say it. You have to know how to do it. Okay. You have to know how to have sex. I mean, it's not just the same bullshit every night. I can understand anybody getting bored with that, but that's not.
So, would you mean like adding like Kama Sutra, like to liven it up per se?
There's no need to liven it up over here. It's never livened down, is what I'm saying, and that's probably.
Hey, that's good.
Okay, I guess maybe you haven't met the right person, Mr. Midnight Movie. Maybe I could say that, perhaps.
Well, like I said, I have my beliefs, and you know, I mean, that's, you know, I choose to, like I said, I
it's just very strange beliefs, darling, is what I'm saying. It's like, remember the other night when you were just blown away with Chris Nelson saying that he thought it was within his right to walk into a crowded airport and yell fire or yell bomb. Remember?
Yes.
Remember, you could not fathom that.
Yes.
That's sort of where I'm at right now, and I believe the panel is at with your line of thinking on relationships. You can't imagine being faithful to anybody.
Well.
Can you? Or can you imagine? Let me ask you that. Is there ever a scenario where you're faithful?
At this point in my life, no. I'm not, well, yeah, not faithful in the terms that you are, but yeah, I mean, in this point in my life, no.
See, that's the part that surprises me the most. At this point in your life. At this point in your life is when you truly should be thinking about a real relationship. When you were in your 20s, you know, that's maybe when you should have sowed all your wild oats. But at this point in your life, when you're 40-something-ish, this is when you should certainly be thinking about the value of a true relationship.
Okay, let me ask another question. Let me pose this to you, sir. Okay, how many women have you ever dated or formed a relationship with, and you have brought this up to them, and they've told you to get lost? I think that's a fair question. Would y'all agree?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very fair.
Yeah, actually, and I had one of them throw a drink at me. It was after we were boyfriend. I mean, you know, we had kind of consummated the relationship, and we were around for a while, and I mentioned that's something that I would probably really enjoy, and something that, you know, and it was something before that I kept hidden, too, because, you know, I kind of wanted to ease them into it. But
would it be fair to say that you are a sexaholic?
That's a good question.
Not at all. I can turn it off at my whim. You know, once, you know, it's like eating. You know, actually, I'm a foodaholic more than I am a sexaholic. food has damaged my health far more than sex ever has.
Well, sex is good for you. Sex is great exercise. So there's nothing wrong with sex.
It says that you can burn up to 300 calories having sex.
Yeah. But that has never. I don't consider myself a sex addict. I am a food addict, but not a sex addict.
And you had a drink thrown in your face when you brought this up to a young lady that you had already consummated a relationship with sexually, and you wanted to search other avenues with her, and she just threw a drink in your face.
Yeah, to a degree, yeah. It was not a good thing. But, you know, I mean...
That sucks, man.
But I also told her, look, if a woman doesn't give me, you know, I mean, unless she's on her period... But if she gets too frigid with me, I'll seek my comfort elsewhere, kind of like the way Red Butler did to Scarlett. You know, if a woman refuses me, I have the right to seek my my comfort elsewhere. I think that was more the argument too.
Very interesting. It is interesting, man. And you know what? I appreciate you being so open. Because a lot of guys would have deviated back to something else just to get the sweat off them. But at least you're continuing with the same process of thought.
I'm learning a lot from this, from listening.
I wonder how many guys are out there that feel this way. I wonder what the numbers would look like.
Well, there are plenty of swingers out there that participate in that lifestyle, and they see nothing wrong with it.
I wonder what the success of those relationships are, though, like in long term, because you can only do that for so long before it just gets old. I mean, or before you get old.
Well, there are plenty of people who've grown old into the swinging lifestyle, who've done it for 20, 30 years.
Really? And they stay, wow, I'd love to, I'm going to look that up. What the stats are on that, because that's an interesting exist. I've known a couple swingers that were clients of mine, and I know that that was their lifestyle, but I wanted no part of it. But that was their lifestyle.
Yeah.
And they had a lot of money, and they were happy with their life, but they drank a lot. They were also alcoholics. Their idea was party every single night.
Yeah.
So that obviously isn't healthy. I mean, none of that was good.
That's also one of the aspect of the swinging lifestyle that I don't like, is a lot of drugs and alcohol are involved in that. And
there are, right?
Yeah. I kind of keep
Now let's examine that. You know, if a person is going to stay anesthetized, I think I said that wrong.
That's, yeah.
Anesthetized to reality, that's going to be skewing one's thinking. And I wonder how many of those women wake up the next morning and think, did I really enjoy looking across the room and watching my husband bang some girl? That's not normal behavior. I mean, am I right or am I wrong here? If it's me, I'll shut up.
It's not normal. I don't think it would be considered normal by anybody's
Mr.
imagination.
Mr. Solution is being way too quiet to be on his panel. I know him. He's got something to say, and I hope it's something that we can all take value in.
Oh, no, I'm listening. It's just that...
How do you feel about it? Are you shocked about this or what? I mean...
Well, not from Brian, because I talk to Brian all the... I mean, I talk to 3M all the time. But see, the problem is two things have to be right in a relationship, which communication is stymied between men and women. But at any rate, you know, you have to select the right person and you have to be the right person. So what I hear him saying is, he's not the right person for a healthy relationship. That's what he's saying. Now, you know, the issue, do you want to become the right person for a relationship? Of course, that's a separate issue. But based upon what he's saying right now, he is not the right person. And see, this is the kind of thing we need to get out in the open during the critical evaluation period. This is what dating is supposed to be about. Now, you know, any woman who wants a healthy relationship would just, you know, bow out, wouldn't try to have one with him because his mind is not there. And you don't need to change a person. This is something that I'm learning, that I have learned and am continuing to learn. But I really promote open and honest communication between men and women so that these kind of things can be discerned. He's incompatible with a healthy monogamous relationship. Is that clear or not?
It's clear to me. It's clear to me that at this point in his life, as he says, he's not ready to do that. And I would think at this time in his life, this is when you absolutely should be.
There you go, Steve. I sent a link to you with percentages and stuff.
Thank you, man.
Yep.
If I just make a point, and this is consistent throughout the English language, is clarity. And, you know, there are really two types of sentences in English, declarative and interrogative. And when English is spoken correctly, it's a series of factual statements, only interrupted by enough information, a question, in order to utter a declarative statement. So a lot of people don't understand that. They're bad communicators, very poor communicators. And I hear what you guys are explaining to Brian, but what Brian is equally explaining to you all, or 3M, excuse me, is that, you know, he doesn't want what you all are suggesting. He doesn't accept the traditional definition of a relationship between the exclusivity of a relationship between a man and a woman. Is that correct, 3M?
Yes.
Yes.
Pretty much. See, that about sums it up.
I understand him perfectly.
Well, I understand where he's coming. I understand what he's saying also, but I believe that there's a reason why he's at this point at his age. Something happened. Something happened to get here. Now this is not a...
Well, experiences do make up, you know, where you have an aha moment, you know. You know,
right.
I mean, where you realize you let that girl get away and then you wanted her. I mean, you have, you know, aha moments.
Stop.
In life.
I knew it. Stop. I knew it. I heard it right there. Stop. Yep. You Wait. Stop. You said you knew you had a girl... And she got away. That's what it is.
Well,
No.
I was saying that about Steve.
Oh, okay.
Steve's girl, but not. I mean, I did have a girl that I was absolutely infatuated with, but that doesn't have any power over me anymore.
You've never used the word love with a girl. You've never said I was in love. You've said the word infatuation. Do you think you're capable to love someone?
I mean, love is at times, I guess, an involuntary emotion. You can't sometimes help who you love or perhaps even who you find attractive. But I don't know. For me, I realize, is this good for me? Is this what I want?
It's a lot about you, and which it should be. It's your life.
Mm.
But there has to be something that happened. There's no way that this at your age, you cannot say that, wow, I would love to find that one girl. Love to settle down with her and have a nice life and grow old with her, you know? I mean, everybody's got to want that. Once you hit 45 plus, it's something you want. Otherwise, something happened and it scarred you so bad that you don't realize even what it is.
Well, to say that I don't want someone, you know, like to share times with and be friends with, but I don't necessarily buy into the whole monogamy thing.
Do you think you ever will? You think you're capable of that?
You know what? Probably when I'm, you know, maybe 10 years, you know, 15 years down the line, when sex has less of an interest, then yes.
It's interesting. So you don't believe anything led you to this point today where you're at, emotionally or otherwise. So it's not another girl. You didn't catch your girl with another guy, and now you're so desensitized and burnt that...
I can help out on this.
Go ahead, Mr. Solution. Go ahead.
Yeah. See, what's happening is, and a lot of people aren't immediately aware of this, conscious of this. But see, our relationships in the U.S. are terrible, and we're not prioritizing them to change it. I mean, we hear about divorces, particularly celebrity divorces, all the time. And relationships are perilous. They're very dangerous today. To get involved with a woman, to live with a woman, can be, for men, it can be a lot of trouble, and particularly if you have anything to lose. We broached this a little bit the other night.
Yes.
So a lot of men are gun shy for a number of reasons. Obviously, you know, they have to exert themselves more than the women, even though women have equal rights. But even beyond that, should a man be able to get in a relationship with a woman? She really holds a hammer over his head for all intents and purposes. And a lot of men don't want that. They don't want that kind of imprisonment. And so that's the reason a lot of men just kind of shy off. There's a book called Men on Strike by Dr. Mary Smith, PhD. So it's either Mary or Susan Smith.
Mr. Solution, can I ask you something? Do you have a phone there? You have your phone with you? I want to see the 214-444-5488 number is accepting calls from my contacts. And now that you're my contact, I'm wondering if we could get a little bit better reception from you if you called.
Yeah, I called it, but no one answered.
Really?
Yes, I called it earlier, and it just rang.
Well, I wasn't in here for a while because would y'all agree his connection is just almost unbearable?
Oh, he sounds faint.
You should have told me.
Oh, did you listen to any of last night's playback?
Oh, yes. It came in pretty well for the most part so far. I haven't listened to all of it.
Okay, then that's fine.
Did you hear it badly?
Well, I couldn't hear you.
I can phone in.
I couldn't hear you at all. So you can't get away this time, because if you try to phone in and don't get in, I can ring you right back into the call. But I'm wondering.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, do y'all hear it, or is it just me?
It has kind of
a
fade.
Coming in very low, Bobby. He's coming in very low.
Okay,
I'm turning up my audio.
Now?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, I was just finishing that. What did I say? I was just finishing that train of thought. There are a number of things, and a lot of men in America have psychologically tuned out. I was talking about Dr. either Mary or Susan Smith, Men on Strike. Someone can look that up. That is very, very essential. A lot of men are not very articulate. Not to say that I'm, you know, greatly articulate, but I think I can articulate some of these things. And if a man is taken to court, and some men have been taken to court, what they call estoppel, if they even try to step in and with a woman with kids, and then for whatever reason, and the kids don't have to be theirs. And if there's a breakup through estoppel, a judge can actually force that man to pay for those kids. It's happened.
Okay, I've got the book review here by my favorite website, Psychology Today. I've got boxes full of these magazines. It says, Men are a strange bunch. We'll fight each other to the death over a patch of land. We'll go to the mat over an imagined insult. Sometimes we'll even brawl just for fun. But we do not enjoy conflict with women. Any relationship therapist can tell you that men tend to retreat from arguments, leaving women frustrated and isolated, leaving relationship problems unresolved. It may be the most common complaint from women about men in their lives. Dr. Helen Smith, a psychologist and blogger, has noticed that men are taking their vanishing act to a whole new level. In her new book, Men on Strike, Why Men Are Boycotting Marriage, Fatherhood, and the American Dream, and Why It Matters, she writes that men are withdrawing on a societal level. Western culture, she believes, has become unjust and hostile towards men. She wastes no time getting to the point in her book, as I will quote, "If we women allow injustice to men today, who knows what will happen to us tomorrow? My actual audience is the man who knows that something in today's 21st century is amiss. He can't put his finger on it exactly, but feels deeply that modern society has turned its back on the average male. All around you, you hear the question, where have all the good men gone? But you know instinctively that that's the wrong question. The right question would be, why have all the good men gone on strike?" She believes men are subconsciously boycotting their lack of reproductive rights, biased family courts, oppressive double standards at universities, belittling of men in general, and hostility towards family men in particular, all of which are pushing men towards solitary lives. She begins with what she calls the marriage strike. While women have increasingly reported that they desire a good marriage, men are dropping out at alarming rates. 18% of men ages 40 to 44 with less than 4 years of college have never married. That's up 6% over the last 25 years. Men who graduate college are also marrying less. 84%, which is a 9-point drop since 1980, she blames family courts that are stacked against men as well as general societal condescension. Consider the spate of recent books with titles like Are Men Really Necessary? And The End of Men and The Rise of Women. Dr. Smith, now y'all know how I feel about this. Dr. Smith offers plenty of horror stories that would make any man cringe. For example, "I met a woman that I'm sure was my soulmate. All this changed when I lost my high-paying job through downsizing. I went to work immediately and had two jobs, but only made about 80% of my old income. My wife gave me a year and then began sleeping with another man who hadn't lost his job in my bed while I was at work. She left with him, almost robbing me of all my savings and anything else that she could carry. The adultery doesn't seem to matter to the court, and she got essentially everything." Initially, it seemed to me that the book relied too heavily on that type of anecdotal evidence. That is, until I recalled my own difficulties gathering data about men. Psychology researchers seem only marginally interested in the mental health of men, and most seem to begin with the assumption that men are predators, drunks, and abusers. For example, there is a line of research suggesting that men become depressed when they act too much like men. Accordingly, foregoing male nature is a path to happiness. That precisely is the type of problem Dr. Smith is writing about. Men are treated as second-class citizens by the social sciences, a state of affairs that undoubtedly steered her toward anecdotal evidence, using plenty of hard data to round out her thesis. Now, let me stop right there and say, comments? Is she right?
It's happened to me, so I'll tell you what. Freaking sounds like my story.
But I'm talking about not you personally, but is she right about what she's saying? Mr. Solution,
yes.
Mr. Midnight Movie, anybody. I just don't want to take it to the personal level. Is she right about the state of affairs in this country?
I believe there's fact in what she's saying. I believe that men are treated unfairly in the courts. I believe that women do get favored in the courts.
Okay, well, what about a prenuptial agreement?
It's not my personal thing, but I think it's something men should do.
Not you personally, Steve. I'm saying, what about...
You know, in California, prenuptial agreements could be overruled.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, but that's a separate issue. The issue is having them in the first place, and you have to bifurcate when you talk about prenuptial agreements. You have to talk about public prenuptial agreement, which is the agreement that comes with signing the marriage.
Well, but here's what I'm trying to say, Mr. Solution. If it's all about that she's going to get everything, then have a prenuptial agreement.
It's not all about that, but that's part of it. But see, to get to that point, men have to be helped to that point, because it's not easy for men to think that way. They don't think about protecting themselves from their partner as they should. But see, it's really not their partner. It's the courts. The courts have sided with women. Am I coming in okay? You have me paranoid, Debbie.
You're fine right now. Okay, I don't know what Debbie's hearing.
The courts use the awesome power of the state to disenfranchise men. So men have to be helped to really protect themselves. Otherwise, they're just, as Dr. Smith says, they're in jeopardy. And they just retreat. That's what men do. You take Bryant, take 3M. He'll talk about beating a man's ass. And I don't know if he'll really do that, but he'll certainly verbalize doing it. He won't talk about how he'll get back at a woman. A woman can kick his ass all over the state, and all he does is just cower, okay? For the most part. And I'm speaking a little bit hyperbolically, but you
can... Yeah, I don't want to make this about any personal attacks. Any personal attacks. But
well,
I understand.
It's not a personal attack. This is actual. This is, you know, this is actual. But if you're saying you don't want me to say it about him...
Well, I'm just...
ask him, is it true? Isn't that true, 3M?
What, that I'll talk about kicking a man's ass and I won't...
Well, you won't talk about defending yourself against a woman. Let's say, not you shouldn't be beating anybody, but you won't talk about defending yourself against a woman, correct?